नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा सम्बुद्धस्स नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा सम्बुद्धस्स नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा सम्बुद्धस्स। गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीबॉडी। I want to continue this talk on metta. I think some of you or most of you have heard that there are many benefits of metta. There is a discourse called Metta Nisangsa Sutta. The discourse itself is titled as The Benefit of Metta Practice. These are not some kind of just theoretical or artificial benefits, but real practical benefit. Only when one very sincerely practices metta, one would see these results within oneself. There are 11 benefits listed in this discourse. And they sound very simple, and yet they are very profound, real, practical benefit. Number one is Sukham Supati, sleep well. When you go to bed, if your mind is full of anger, hatred, really hating somebody, can you sleep? You'll be planning how to talk to that person, what to do to that person, how you react to the things that the person has said or done to you. And all these are in your mind. As I said, the whole world is in your mind. So you open this particular file of people, and then you pull out this person or persons or situations, pull out from that file when you go to bed, and keep thinking of that person or the situation, and you cannot have a wink of sleep because you are planning something, because it hurts you very much. You cannot sleep. But if you have been practicing metta, at that moment you cannot practice metta because the mind is already obsessed with the thought of revenging and saying something nasty or doing something or getting very angry. At that moment you cannot practice metta, honestly. Therefore, if you have been practicing metta, when you go to bed, the very last thought of the day would be metta thought. You go to bed with metta. Now, these benefits are not the benefits that you gain by occasional metta practice or ritualistic metta practice. But these benefits you get only if you diligently, mindfully, sincerely practice metta. Buddha mentioned in one of the discourses, he asked the bhikkhus, suppose a child practices metta from childhood, do you expect him to kill living beings? You can never expect a child to kill a living being who has been practicing metta from childhood. Probably you might have noticed some children by nature loves animals, even little insects. They like them, they don't want to hurt, that is their nature. In addition to that, if that child also practices metta, when he goes to bed as an adult, as a child of course there is no problem in sleeping, as an adult, his mind is already filled with metta, and he can sleep very well. We, as adults, who might have not been practicing metta from childhood, at this age of our life, we start to practice. And if we do it, even now, it's not too late. Even now, very sincerely, just leaving resentment aside, if we practice even now, we too can have this benefit. Going to sleep, going to bed and have a good sleep. Sleeping well does not simply mean like sleeping like a, what? Anybody, you know, who works very hard, you know, labor, you know, laboring whole day, working in the field, in factories, in driving and so forth and so on, can sleep. That sleep is not considered to be well sleep. You may be snoring, you may be twisting, turning, and having not having a rest. It is not very restful sleep. But it is just because of you are so fatigued, you just fall asleep. But somebody who has not been engaged in any such tedious, laborious work can also sleep very well, peacefully, mindfully. The person can sleep. And then as a result of sleep well, can get up well. In the morning, the person will be not grouchy, grumpy and upset and, you know, irritated. Some people, when they get up in the morning, any tired little thing can irritate them. It takes few hours to have a cup of tea, a cup of coffee or tea, and little exercise and so forth and so on. Only then person really wakes up. And only then you can talk to the person. Before that, very difficult to talk. Any tiny thing he can irritate the person. You might have seen people like that. But if you practice metta, you can sleep well. When you get up well in the morning, you will be like a flower blossoming in the morning, very relaxed and peaceful. You are easy to talk to, and very nice feeling you have. In between this is the second benefit. Third benefit is in between sleep and getting up, you will not have nightmares. Bad, very frightening, horrible dreams. Your dreams will be sweet dreams, sweet sleep. We say, have sweet dreams, we say, when you go to bed. You cannot have sweet dreams if you don't practice metta. When you have a dream, if you have any, those dreams would be very, very peaceful, meaningful dreams. People who interpret dreams can, sometimes they interpret peaceful dreams in a positive way. So you will have not nightmares. Then that's called harmful dreams. You can hear sometimes people scream in sleep at night because of nightmares. Then fourth benefit, because of all this, now just imagine you slept well, got up well, did not have nightmares, then next morning you will be pleased to other people. Other people like to see your face. Manussanam piyohoti. Your face becomes pleasant. It doesn't look angry face or a grumpy face. Your face will be pleasant face. Why? Because the beauty comes from within. Beauty comes from the thought of friendliness. When you get up with anger, that is what everybody can see on your face. When you get up with metta, that is what people see on your face. You cannot hide what is inside on the face. When you get angry, even though you may not say anything, anybody can tell that you are angry. Your face is blushed and reddened, and eyebrows are, you know, very funny looking. Lips are dry. So all you can see on your face. When you are peaceful, happy with metta, that also people can notice. And people become glad. It is a joy for them to be with those people who can relax and talk too easily. Then amanussanam piyohoti, manussanam piyohoti, amanussanam piyohoti. The one who practices metta would be loved by even non-human beings. Some non-human beings we cannot see. Invisible beings, sometimes you believe in deities, and they love to see you. Even animals would be pleased with the person who practices metta. I think probably you know, your dog, when you are upset, you can see your dog notices it. And dog will be really, you know, cautious that day. Why? You are upset. When you are not upset, you are very happy. Dog will come and jump on you and sit on your lap and lick your face and shows his affection because he is not afraid to get close to you. When you are upset, dog also is very careful, be cautious, because you can snap him very quickly and shout at him or do something. So cats, dogs, even wild animals, not vicious wild animals, like harmless wild animals. If you live in a forest, practice metta, these animals feel the vibe, the vibration coming out of your body. We all have an aura. We all have it. And in our aura, they feel friendliness. If we are full of anger, also they feel it. Because it emanates, radiates through our aura. So, amanusanam piyohoti. Next is devata rakkanti. And we are protected by deities. Protecting by deities, there is, you remember Ratana Sutta? Ratana Sutta, says, tasmāhi bhūtāni sāmeta sabbe, tasmāhi bhūtāni sāmeta sabbe, mettaṁ karota manusya pajāya, divāca rattoca harantiye bali. It is said that even the Buddha asked deities, whichever, whoever, wherever the deities are, Buddha asked them, show your loving friendliness to human beings, mettaṁ karota manusya pajāya. Show your kindness, your metta to human beings who bring you offerings day and night. Divāca rattoca harantiya balin. Divā means daytime, ratta means night, harantiya balin. Bala means offering. Bali. So human beings, those days, in the Buddha's time, even today, bring offerings to various deities. And Buddha said, therefore, show them your loving friendliness. So people who practice loving friendliness will receive loving friendliness from even deities and protect them. They protect them. When we are upset, angry, grouchy, grumpy, hateful, who likes us? Everybody tries to stay away, holding us at arm's length, and so she cannot try to get close to us. So, then, devata rakkanti. Then there are three other benefits. They are called nasa, agyengva, visangva, sattangva, kamati. I want to emphasize this benefit because of misunderstanding of this benefit. Nasa, agyengva, sattangva, visangva, kamati. The metta meditators will not be affected by weapons, poisons, and fire. Fire, poison, weapon. And people literally believe in that. They literally believe that they will not be burnt if they practice metta. Fire will not affect them, poison will not affect them, and weapons will not affect them. Friends, if you believe in that, literally, practicing metta, you are practicing metta, somebody comes behind and shoot. Doesn't the bullet go through your body? Can you stop the bullet? Somebody comes with a sharp knife and stab. Doesn't the blade go through your body? Somebody set fire on you. You don't know, you are sitting meditating, deeply concentrating, deeply practicing metta. Somebody comes and set fire. Don't you get burned? You definitely get burned. There are stories. Some interpret these stories in their favor, ignoring the reality, taking these three literally. I'll tell you one story among at least two. There was a... Let me tell you this story first. Woman called Sama, Samavati. In Anguttara Nikaya, Buddha said the metta practitioners, he said the etadaggambheke mama gihi upasikanam metta metta bhava metta viharinam yadidam samavati. Because among lay people who practice metta, I declare samavati as number one. Etadaggam bhikkhave gihi upasaka upasika upasaka gihi metta viharena yadidam samavati. In Etadagga Pali, first volume in Anguttara Nikaya. Among lay meditators, I declare Samavati as number one. This woman was King Udayana's queen among many women. She was his queen. She had a servant called Kujyuttara. That's a long story. Anyway, this servant girl went to Buddha and learned Dhamma and came back and taught Dhamma to His Majesty's wives, these women. They were so proud they did not want to listen to the Buddha. Or they were not allowed to go and see the Buddha. But this woman came and taught them Dhamma. And Samavati learned metta meditation. She learned metta meditation so well that every week she had metta retreat for 500 women. And they were practicing metta. There was another woman who also was a wife of King Udayana. Her name was Magandhya. Magandhya was very, very angry with the Buddha. Why? When Magandhya was unmarried, her father brought her to the Buddha and asked him to marry her. Buddha rejected her. Up to that point, she has rejected very many young people because she was one of the most beautiful girls. And she rejected every young man who proposed to her. But finally, when her father brought her to the Buddha, Buddha rejected her. So she was very upset and wanted to take revenge from the Buddha. And finally she married this king, Udayana. Now she was the second wife of King Udayana. First one was Samavati. Now Samavati was practicing metta and Magandhya wanted, Samavati was practicing metta following the Buddha's Dhamma, following the Buddha. And Magandhya, in order to hurt the Buddha, she wanted to hurt Samavati. See the anger, the way how anger works. jealousy work, revenge work. She could not hurt the Buddha. And therefore she selected one of the supporters of the Buddha, following Buddha. So she plotted in many, many ways. She tried many, many things to hurt her, hurt Samavati. Finally, one day when they were practicing meditation, in metta meditation, they were practicing, that moment she got her own uncle and asked him to set fire to the house where they were sitting and meditating. Close all the doors and pour oil and set fire to the house. All these 500 women, including Samavati, died in that fire. Now, she was not only practicing metta, but teaching metta and meditating together with other women. And she died in fire. And she died with other 500 women who also were practicing metta. If the fire doesn't affect one who practices metta, how come these 500 women died in fire? So people literally believe that if you practice metta, fire will not affect you. There are many other stories to prove this point, but they all disprove the point. Therefore, Buddha's words never become false. Buddha never spoke anything false, anything wrong. Buddha never lied. He spoke the truth. But when we misunderstand the truth, it can get into very, very wrong state. This is a misunderstanding of the Dhamma. What it really means is, in this book we have one discourse called Aditya Pariyaya Sutta. 5 sermons in Vandana book, you can read. There Buddha says, Chakkhum bhikkhave adittam. Chakkhum adittam. Rupe adittam. Chakku vinyanam adittam. Chakku sampasso aditto. Yaditan chakku sampasa pachya upajit veditan sukhanga dukhanga adukama sukhanga thampi adittam. Kena adittam? Ragagina, dosagina, mohagina adittam. Manani, because eyes are on fire. Visual objects are on fire. Eye consciousness is on fire. Eye contact is on fire. Whatever sensation, pleasant, unpleasant, or neutral that arises due to eye contact also are on fire. On what fire? Fire of greed, fire of hatred, fire of delusion. And this is the fire we have to extinguish. Fire of hatred, fire of greed, fire of delusion. And it is this fire that will not affect us when we practice metta. When we practice metta, hatred will not affect, our hatred will not affect us. Why? Our hatred slowly becomes weak. Hatred subsides. And the hatred of others also will not affect us. Why? When we practice metta and always behave in metta, generally normal-minded people have no reason to hurt us, normally. And therefore, and poison, Buddha mentioned in many places, greed is hate, greed is fire, greed is poison, greed is weapon. Hatred is fire, hatred is weapon, hatred is poison. Delusion is fire, delusion is weapon, delusion is poison. These are the poison of anger, poison of mind, poison of greed, poison of mind, poison of delusion, poison of mind. When we practice metta, friends, all these three poisons, three weapons, three fires will not affect our mind. Because these fires, poisons, weapons are in our mind. Where is the hatred? Anger. Where is the greed? Where is delusion? In our mind. So we treat our mind when we practice metta. So, therefore we must understand this are metaphorical, figurative, not literal. So if it is literal, Sama and 500 women wouldn't have been killed by the fire. Okay. Then, Dāsāgīvā viṣṇava sattvāma kamati tuvataṁ cittaṁ samādhyati. When you practice metta, you gain concentration very quickly. Why? Two of our hindrances we can overcome by practicing metta. What are the two hindrances? Hindrance of greed, hindrance of hatred. Hindrance of greed is called near enemy, because greed, clinging, craving can disguise as friendliness and hurt us. Anger or hatred is considered to be far enemy, because it is very obvious. And these two are called hindrances in the practice of concentration, meditation. These two are called hindrances. When we practice metta, both of these hindrances will be subsided, and that helps us to gain concentration. Another thing, when we practice metta, I think I mentioned this earlier, we don't focus our mind on any particular individual. Individual's concept of individuality, we eliminate, we merge everyone into one unit, one living unit, living, breathing beings. Because we don't have time to verbalize anything when we are gaining concentration. When we are gaining concentration, you remember when we go to second jhana, for instance, vitakka vichara, or verbalizing, conceptualizing, subside. Instead, mind becomes calm, peaceful, concentrated due to absence of initial thought and sustained thought. At that state, the mind is full of the thought of letting go of greed, hatred and delusion. Letting go. We have no fraction of a second even to think of any desirable object or hateful object, because mind is so calm and peaceful. And that time, we gain concentration. The basis of this is the proximate cause of jhanic meditation, the concentration. When you practice jhanic meditation, after overcoming hindrances and so forth, The proximate cause of gaining concentration is metta practice. Why? We let go of our greed and hatred. Therefore, we gain concentration very, very quickly. Mind is, because mind is calm.